signal from the man at the back, right? Your microphone is off. Thank you. So for those that are worshiping online with us tonight, thank you for joining us. We invite you to take just a moment and prepare elements for Holy Communion. If you have a hand wipe or a towel around as well, you'll want that for later on in the service as well. As we share in our worship together this evening, just a reminder for tomorrow, for Good Friday, there are two different events that you are invited to participate in. The first is over the noon hour, beginning at 11 o'clock, from 11 to just before noon, and then from noon to 1 is a service at St. John's Mickley's, where we'll be observing the Stations of the Cross. From 11 to 12 is Come and Go. It is a self-guided meditation, and you're invited to be a part of that. If you come at noon, then it is guided by the clergy of our UCC areas that are participating, and we invite you to be a part of the Stations of the Cross experience together. Then tomorrow evening, here at this St. John's, we have a marvelous service of Tenebrae, a service of Shadows and Darkness that we invite you to be a part of. It is beautiful, it is meaningful. The music, the scripture, the message will all guide us to an even greater experience of Easter Sunday. We hope that you will plan to be a part of that service tomorrow evening as well. With those things in mind then, let me invite you to take just a moment to stand where you are or reach across the aisle to share a hug, a handshake, a wave, a smile, whatever it might be, as your way to share your greeting. And as we gather together, we offer each other the peace of Christ. My friends, may the peace of Christ be with you. Let's stand and welcome one another in worship. And good evening, good evening. Good to see you, good to see you. Hello, good to see you. God's peace. We invite you to be seated and let's prepare our hearts to worship God together.
please rise and join me in the call to worship. We are Jesus' disciples, following him even as he moves toward the cross.
Even as he wraps a towel around his waist, even as he kneels to wash the feet of his friends.
We are Jesus' disciples, longing to be faithful even as night grows dark.
Even as betrayers loom, even as the powers that oppose the way of Christ press in around us.
We are Jesus' disciples, struggling to love others even as Jesus loved us.
We are Jesus' disciples, gathered here to worship God, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer.
Amen. Please remain standing to sing together, I Come With Joy. Please remain standing as together we share a gathering prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks this night for the privilege of gathering to remember, to celebrate, and to share. We give you thanks for the journey we have been on with you, from manger to temple, from Egypt to Galilee, from darkness to light. Tonight we feast as you did on a night like this so long ago, remembering your promises, your mighty deeds, your rescue of your people, your saving grace. As we share this meal tonight, make us mindful of those who are hungry. As we celebrate together, make us mindful of those who sorrow and those who are alone, as we remember once again all you have done and all that you are, form us once again into your people. May all who hunger come to rejoice in the feast of your kingdom. Let all the human family sit at your table, drink the wine of deliverance, and eat the bread of freedom. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Together, let us share in the call to confession. God's love for the world has been revealed in Jesus Christ, who at his last meal with his disciples gave them and us a new commandment: love one another, just as I have loved you. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Merciful God, we confess that so often our discipleship has been weak when we have failed to serve as Jesus served. We ask for forgiveness. When we have failed to love one another as Jesus loved us, we ask for forgiveness. When we have been happy to proclaim our devotion to Jesus with our lips and then denied him by our actions,
we ask for forgiveness. Merciful God, empower us by your Spirit to be steady and true to you in every time of trial.
Jesus said, I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. And having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The good news, therefore, is this. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of God's word. Our scripture reading is from the book of John. Since it was a day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because the Sabbath was a day of great solemnness. So they asked Pilate to have his legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look upon the one they have pierced. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. You may be seated.
Thank you, Tom. I received a message from the back. Just take a look at the window for a moment. Isn't that magnificent? God is good. all the time, and all the time, God is good. God did this for you. In tonight's message, I have redeemed you. We're looking again, as we did on a Wednesday evening devotional, just briefly, but in addition to that, on God's promise in the blood and the water that come from Jesus' pierced side, but also the gifts of Christ's body and blood given to us in the holy meal of the sacrament of communion. And tonight as well, the gift of water that is used to wash the disciples' feet. Water and water and water. From the scripture lesson that was shared, invite you also to hear from Luke 22 in the preparation of the Passover. As they came to the day of unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed, Jesus sent Peter and John saying, "Go and prepare the Passover meal for us that we may eat it." They asked him, "Where do you want us to make preparations for it?" "Listen," he said to them, "when you have entered the city, a man carrying a jar of water." Water. "A man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house he enters and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks you, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, already furnished. Make preparations for us there.' So they went and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When the hour came, he took his place at the table and the apostles with him. And he said to them, 'I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God.' Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks said, 'Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes.' Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks for it, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And he did the same with the cup after the supper, again saying, 'This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood.'" My friends, we have journeyed together with Jesus from Galilee to Jerusalem, from his miracles and meals on the mountainsides to the healing in homes, to his entry into Jerusalem as he comes as one coming in peace, only to have that peace challenged and shattered by those who would seek to betray him, those who in crisis would flee in the night and deny him in the darkness. We've come to this Thursday in Holy Week, fully knowing what tomorrow will bring, where they did not. Yet on this night, we're reminded of a new commandment. The call of Jesus with a mandate to love, from which the name Maundy comes, from the Latin mandatum, a mandate, a command to love one another. That's the focus of this day. We've made it about communion over the years, when the command of the day is all grounded in love. What does that love, that warm, fuzzy sentiment mean when there's so much at stake? Perhaps it is simply this, that God's redeeming grace, that God's unconditional love for us will not be stopped by the actions of human beings. No, instead, God will have the final word, and that word will be love. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. That's what Jesus has done for us. The good things we embrace on this night of intimate fellowship and deep servant leadership is rooted in the empowering command to love. So what Jesus does for us once and for all is because of who Jesus is and what Jesus does, and that because of these things, we are then counted as those who are righteous in the eyes of God. Because of God's love and Jesus' actions, we receive the gift of being redeemed, and we receive the gift of being kept in the embrace of God's love. And so as we think about the water and the blood, the bread, the wine, the water that is shared in serving, I invite you to pray with me. And now, loving God, speak to us, your people. Let our hearts experience these sacred symbols yet again and see them as gifts of love that you have prepared for us in this, the final days of our Lenten journey. Let us this night welcome the Christ you promised, the one in whose name we have gathered and in whose name we pray. Amen. Tonight we participate in a communion service, a time of remembrance in which the Seder meal, the Passover meal, was being celebrated, and in which Jesus would forever change how the disciples would come to understand that meal, what would take place in those moments. Some congregations on this night even do a foot washing. Fear not, friends. This is a modern day worship time. We're not asking anyone to take your shoes off. Please do not. Instead, we will be sharing in a ritual of hand washing. They're all appropriate. They're meaningful observations, observances, filled with significance. There's something incredible about a moment in which you get to wash someone else's feet, and when others wash yours. If you've never had that experience, hold on. There may be a day when we'll give you that opportunity. But tonight, it's hand washing. All these things, if we don't hear and heed the mandate, the new commandment to love, all of these things will be in vain. We'll have missed the point of this Holy Thursday if we fail to notice the basin, the water, the towel. Sometimes we pass by them awfully quickly because we're in a hurry to get to the meal. Garrison Keillor told a story of his uncle, who at an annual family gathering during Holy Week would read the story of Jesus' passion and death. And each year, when he came to the verses that would describe the betrayal of Jesus, the uncle would almost burst into tears, unable to hold in his emotion. The rest of the family would sit by a bit awkwardly, watching this elderly relative almost unable to continue his reading till he had collected himself. Keeler commented that his uncle took the death of Jesus so personally. He'd pause in the story, and then he would add, "The rest of the church had gotten over that years ago." It seems to me that our failure to take the mandate seriously is perhaps proof that Keeler's uncle and Keeler himself were right. Hopefully tonight's service will invite us to think again about God's redeeming grace with fresh eyes. The water, the basin, the towel. During the supper, Jesus, knowing that God had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was returning to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. He poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. And he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not only my feet then, but also my hands and my head." John 13. In many churches around the world tonight, they will commemorate this Maundy Thursday, this mandate to love that Jesus shares, with a foot washing. And I was kind of hedging bets. Will the choir outnumber the congregation tonight? Choir, you're in luck. The congregation has outnumbered you by 7 at my last count, so, you know, we're in good shape. It has been the experience throughout much of the church in recent decades that this is one of the most poorly attended services. We're all about the cross. We get into the darkness. Why do we not get into the love? The command to love. It's been my experience also that people are quite willing, when there is a foot washing service, to wash someone else's feet. That's almost like a badge of honor, a sign of our piousness, of our spirituality, how humble we really are. Or not. It's a little problematic every now and then, because then someone has to wash your feet. And we find ourselves echoing the words of Peter almost, don't we? My feet? Oh, no, no, no. Here, let me serve you. Americans are almost phobic about exposing our feet. What is it about the feet? Are they an ultimate symbol, perhaps, of our mortality? You know, we put a tag around people's toe when they go to the morgue? Is there something we have around people's feet that reminds us of our vulnerability? Maybe it's just vanity. Have you seen some people's feet? I mean, my goodness, I'd keep them covered too. Sometimes perhaps our feet are the reminder of the grimy side of our Christian life. In ancient times, they would wash the dirt off their feet because they were walking along dirt roads. And as they would come into someone's home, the gift of hospitality was to wash the guests' feet as they came into your home. In many traditions throughout the world today, there is still the custom of entering into the front door, and there's a place right there for you to take off your shoes and not bring them into the rest of the house, tracking in the dirt of the day. We're not alone, really. But Peter was adamant that Jesus should not wash his feet. And Jesus was equally insistent that he should. You see, Peter understood clearly that Jesus was taking on the role of the slave, the servant of the house, the lowest of the roles, by the way. Washing the feet of people who walked on unpaved streets in sandals was a nasty, dirty job. And if you think you are uncomfortable having your feet washed, imagine how Peter might have felt that night. But Jesus is insistent because he knows. There's something more that he knows and understands. As much as anything else that he ever said or ever did, he understood that this action alone would be the defining character by which people would know that they were his disciples. How they were to live, how they were to love, how they were to share with each other. The way love would show up in their lives would make all the difference. The way love shows up in our lives still today makes all the difference. So tonight, we wash each other's hands. Our hands that we reach out in service and care and compassion. Our hands that we reach out in friendship and in joy and in celebration. Our hands that we reach out in support to lift those who may be trapped in sorrow, or place an arm around those who are grieving, or simply to be present and to hold the hand of another so that they know they are not alone. We wash one another's hands, and we will model the love of God for each of us as we share in this role of serving, in this role of loving, humbling ourselves. Being a part of this role of redeeming still today. For you see, when we shared in the Wednesday evening devotionals on this same passage about Jesus' own body being pierced by the soldiers that Tom read for us just a few moments ago, we noted then that both blood and water came from Jesus' side, both necessary symbols. Reminders for us of redemption and renewal, of forgiveness and love. Water, again, reminding us of love. A moment when water is not just about getting cleaned up, but about being prepared and embraced and renewed in love. In the upper room and at Calvary's cross, Christ's work for us and Christ's work in us remind us of the gifts that God shares in grape and grain, in bread and wine, in water and blood, that we are forgiven, that we are redeemed, that we are loved. God's work for us and God's work in us, both of them are necessary. Both gifts moisten the dirt at the base of the cross. So then, what's the big deal about the feet and the foot washing? We could so easily skip over that part of the story, but Jesus doesn't let us. Because after all, it's not the meal that is the new command. We're told to remember, we're commanded to love. We're invited to declare the love by God, and that we are loved, that others are loved by us. That others will know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we are those who follow Jesus Christ because of this example. This is what we're commanded to do. However, it is our serving in love, our humbling ourselves, our willingness to witness and honor others, and to declare them loved by God and loved by us, that ultimately helps people know what a follower of Jesus looks like. Because, friends, there are many who will say, well, I'm a follower of Jesus. Really? Your actions seem to say otherwise. Well, I'm a follower of Jesus. Really? Your compassion or lack thereof leads me to question that. Well, I'm a follower of Jesus. I've got the Bible that says, God bless America. You should know I'm a follower of Jesus. I'm going to question that. I'm going to wonder just a little bit more. Will we see your love? Will we see your love? Love, once again, has the final word in our witness. It will not matter what words we say, what political party we belong to, what school we graduated from, what job title we have. What will matter to others is if our life matches up with our declared values, if our actions are in sync with the Savior that we say we follow. That'll be the sign. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You should also love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. I have redeemed you, Jesus says. Now, what will we do next? Run and hide? Lash out in anger? Flee when the going gets tough? Plot to have our own way? Deny the divine one in our lives because it isn't convenient to be associated with the way of love right now? All these things are why Jesus knew that the meal would not be enough. Even the washing by water and the command to love and the prayer in the garden and the long journey to the cross would all be needed for us to grasp redeeming love. The journey of the cross. God did this just for us, to redeem us. Thanks be to God. Amen.
In the night.
We worship God, and as we do so, we receive that command to love, and we take it seriously, that we share in our love for God and our love for one another as we come to moments of prayer. So I invite you to be mindful of those that are listed in our order of worship tonight. Added into that, last night, a member of our congregation, Mike Agrippine, was in an automobile accident and was injured, but is doing well. Still in the hospital, but our prayers for Mike tonight are appreciated as well. May we pray. Our God of many names, hear us as we come to you. As Jesus gathered with his friends in the upper room and in the Garden of Gethsemane to pray before his passion, so may we offer from our hearts the names of those we love and those we name before you. Holy God, hear our prayers. Gracious God, as those who strive to follow Jesus in our living, to trust your power, even in our dying, we worship you. We reflect upon the life that ended on a cross. We recognize in ourselves the strengths and weaknesses of Jesus' disciples. Although they loved him, they disappointed and failed him. And yet, gathering with these imperfect friends at this last meal, Jesus washed their feet in service. And then he extended the bread and the cup to each. Jesus called them to love one another and then invited them to share in his very life and his acceptance of the road ahead. So on this Holy Thursday night, we too are humbled and honored and inspired by the deep love Christ extended to the world. And we take seriously the calling to be the body of Christ today, the beloved community. In your forgiveness, when we disappoint and fail you, guide us back to a place of trust and faithful living. And God, grant us the vision to see the world as you see it, to love with compassion for each creature and for all of your creation. For God of grace and love, all this we pray in your many names. You who taught us in ancient and new words to pray together, saying, mystery beyond our knowing, close to us as our breathing, in humble awe we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. We pray for your vision and justice and mercy to be made real in our world even now. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. We pray for your vision of enough, enough sustenance, enough warmth, enough health for all of your children. Give us today our daily bread. We pray for the grace to let go of that which is death-dealing as we embrace your vision for life, that we might follow you safely through the obstacle course, forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Giving thanks for presence that defies definition in this life and beyond. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. This evening, as we receive our gifts together, we're reminded of the great gifts that God has given. We've looked at them all in this Lenten journey. And yet there are still a couple more that we will embrace along the way. Each of these gifts that cause within us to be able to rejoice and sing, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. So as we receive these gifts, may we offer ourselves in faith as well. Let's stand and sing our praise.
Let us together offer a prayer of dedication. God of abundance in every form, through these gifts and the actions of our lives, may all that we share bring the world to your heart of grace and love. Amen. Please be seated.
So on our altar this evening, we have the pitcher of water, the basin, the towel, as those symbols that remind us of this act of service that Jesus shared. And in the center sections of your pews, you'll find our hand-washing implements tonight. I'll share these here for the choir as well. We want you to take a moment. If there's not someone seated next to you, find them nearby, around you. Help each other in this time. You'll find the little towelettes that are there. Take one. Wipe the other person's hands. Let them take one. Wipe your hands as we share in this act of washing one another. Cleansing, renewing, refreshing each other in the love of Christ. And as we share in this act of love towards our friends and neighbors, our siblings in faith, may we be reminded of all that Christ has done for us. We're going to give the choir just a moment to also be able to share in our ritual of hand washing in preparation for Holy Communion. Those who are at home, this is your cue to be able to also take that towelette that you may have at home. Use that to symbolically wash your hands. Have those gifts of bread and wine or something to be able to share as we share in Holy Communion together. We will be sharing the gifts of communion being passed through the pews this evening to be able to share those with each other. And as we share the gifts of God together, we remember who we are as a family of faith. We are an inclusive community. In the United Church of Christ, we observe an open communion, which means that all persons are welcome to receive the gifts of God's grace and love with us at the table. In the United Church of Christ, all means all. And so you're invited to receive. Join me in the invitation. It would not have been God's table if they hadn't all been gathered around it. The betrayer and the friend, the power hungry and the justice seeker, the faithful and the fickle. When Jesus poured the wine and the bread was broken, when everyone could eat, the outcast and the beloved, the arrogant and the gracious, the wrongdoer and the wrongly done by, the table becomes a foretaste of love made real and of a world made whole. Your company at the table will include the betrayer and the beloved, the wrongdoer and the wrongly done by. It would not be God's table without them. And the promise is that when we are together, when you tell the story and give the blessing, when you break the bread and pour the wine, you will discover a foretaste of love made real and of a world made whole. So we remember on that night in which Jesus gathered with his disciples how the Lord Jesus took the bread, and he blessed it and broke it and shared it with all in the room and said, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after the supper again, the Lord Jesus took the cup, shared the blessing of God upon the cup as he shared it with everyone in the room and said, "Take and drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant in my love that is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of all of God's mighty acts for us in Jesus the Christ, we offer ourselves in praise, in thanksgiving for all that Christ has done for us. And we ask God's blessing upon the gift, upon those that receive, and upon the world that we will transform because of these gifts. May we receive in faith as we share together. Those who are to assist in serving, come. Thank you. the body of Christ given for us. Thanks be to God. Amen. The cup of our salvation given for us. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please join me in our prayer of thanksgiving. We have come to the table, imperfect and flawed, yet you in Christ have received us and offered us healing and hope. Forgive our waywardness, heal our brokenness, challenge us to live lives of faithfulness and discipleship. Having received these gifts, Now we go out into the darkness of the garden. After the Last Supper, less than 24 hours remained in our Lord's earthly life. Events moved rapidly. Prayer in Gethsemane, betrayal by Judas, arrest, mock trial, painful beating, the trudge to Golgotha, and execution. As his life was stripped from him, so we strip our altar of the signs of comfort and life to symbolize his suffering and death. Tonight, as we bring ourselves to a close, we will remove the symbols of our faith and proclamation of the gospel in what is known as the stripping of the altar. It is an ancient custom of the church done typically on Maundy Thursday or on Good Friday. As we share in these preparations, hear the word of God for us.
A reading from the 26th chapter of Matthew. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "So, you could not stay awake with me for 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak."
We extinguish our altar candles. We remove these symbols that remind us of the light of Christ as he prepares to pray in the garden, leading to his passion. Our offerings that we lift before our altar represent one way of loving God and serving God in us and sending us the Son, Jesus, in human form. As the offered body of Jesus was removed from sight and burial, so we remove our plates for offering. Jesus' offered body and his shed blood have been given to us in the form of bread and wine and juice in this holy mystery. As he was removed from us in the grave, so we remove the vessels of this sacrament. Our altar and communion table are where our Lord Jesus serves us as both host and meal at his banquet feast. The coverings are made of fine linen, material appropriate for feasting with our King. As our King's body was stripped in crucifixion, so our altar and table are stripped of their coverings. And finally, the remaining consecrated bread and wine represent to us Christ's body. They are carried to the rear of the sanctuary. They'll be veiled, representing his lying in the tomb. Tonight we pause, we end in the garden, we watch and pray. Tomorrow for Good Friday, a reminder of the Stations of the Cross, opportunity for us to observe around the 11 to 1 hours, either come and go or together in gathered community, and again our service of darkness here at 7 o'clock. And then I hope you will also be joined with family, friends, others whom you love and want to celebrate this special Lord's Day with on Easter Sunday as we celebrate the resurrection, share in Holy Communion, and celebrate in flowering our resurrection cross together. As we go from this place today, let us go receiving the gift of God in this benediction. Now may you live as long as you want and never want as long as you live. May the road rise up to meet you, the wind always be at your back. May God hold you in the palm of God's hand as you make your journey to Calvary's cross, to the empty tomb, down the road to eternal life that is given for each of us. Go in God's grace and peace. Amen.